everyone. I'm back with my next episode of Sunday Stories. And as you all must have read the title of the story is What Goes Around Comes Around. We have heard and learned many stories and poems based on this particular theme. If you all remember, we have done Inchcape Rock. And this is a similar story. I'll have two short stories for you. One is the main story and one is also of a similar type. So let's start. So here in this little town, there was a very poor villager. He used to grow crops. He used to grow fruits and used to work very, very hard. He used to work and toil day and night on his fields so that he could have a good harvest and then a successful year ahead. So this time, his fruits harvest was very, very good. By God's grace, his vineyard was full of grapes, beautiful grapes, big ones, juicy ones, very nutritious, very healthy and attractive to look at. So when they were ready, he himself was very happy and very thankful to God and felt that he was not the one who should start eating with that. He wanted to offer it to someone who had helped him in his bad times. Yes, we all offer whenever we make good things, like it is me, you know. Whenever I make something good, I have one small Krishan ji, I call him Thakur ji. I regard him just like my baby, my brother, everything he is. Like, I don't have a brother. So whenever I have to tie a rakhi or do tikka, talk to him, I go and talk to my Thakur ji. Alright? So, I usually, whatever I make, I first feed him. Then, you know, then anyone can eat. So, he felt, you know, he kept it in front of God and then felt that, no, this, after that, you know, once we, obviously, we are feeding it to the idol or to the God. God is not here with us. We feel that God has eaten. All right. God is here, but like a human being, he is not present. So we pick it up and then we eat. So what he felt was that he was not the first person who should eat it. The one who had helped him was the monk in the monastery. So he quickly, you know, he offered the fruits to God and then took the bunch of those beautiful grapes, the juicy ones, the big ones. All right. And he took them and he went to the monastery. So he quickly knocked the door and it was opened by the same monk who used to open every day. He was like every day he was there at the gate. His duty was to be there at the gate and to help anyone who comes crying or who's in problem. So he had the duty at the gate. So everybody used to meet him. So he went and he opened and he offered the grapes to him. So he said, this time by God's grace and your help, my fruits, my orchard, my vineyard is full of fruits. This time I'm going to earn very, very well and I want to share my joy with you because you are the one who helped me that time when my crops had failed. They had all got destroyed due to drought. I had come crying to you. You were the one who took me in. You were the one who gave me food. You were the one who came with me to my house to see my fields. You were the one, you prayed with me to God. You helped me. I can never forget the help that, the moral support that you gave me that day. Of course, he was a monk. He could not have given anything else. No money, nothing, you know. Whatever that monk could help, he had done in that way. So, the grapes were given to him. So he said, all right. these are lovely and I'm going to go and give them to the abbot because he's the head over here. And thank you so much because I am just a person at the gate. He's the one who is the credit goes to. So he said, no, this is not for him. I have never met him. I have come to thank you. So the monk took them and smiled and, you know, blessed that villager, and that villager went away very happily. So, you know, he went inside, he took those grapes and he kept in his room, and the monk kept looking. The beauty of those grapes, the God, by God's grace, they were so beautiful. The sun had helped it, you know, grow so nicely and so juicy. It was all because of the blessings of God. He just, you know, didn't feel that he could eat it. Said, no. The abbot has trained me so well. That is why I'm able to look at people, you know, so well. So I should go to the abbot and offer this because he is my senior. He tells me what to do, what not to do. And how can I eat before him? I respect him. I have to go and give this to the abbot. He went and gave those grapes to the abbot. The abbot was also, you know, very like astonished to see the look, the attractiveness of those grapes. They were so beautiful. You know, those grapes, sometimes, you know, something you feel, you know, they are so beautiful. So the abbot also looked at those grapes, and when the monk went away, he felt that, should I eat them? You know, these people at monastery, they believe in helping people, to do charity, to help all. So the abbot also felt, no, I am very well off. I have everything that God has given. So many people offer me so many things. But this, you know, these grapes tell, their beauty talks that they are God, blessed by God. I should go and give it to the sick man in the neighborhood. He is the one who is more needy. So he quickly took those grapes and he felt, you know, that sick man was so sick. He wanted all these juicy things, and they could recover him very well. And he would be, because when a person is sick, he's depressed also. So he will become very happy. And so he went to that sick man. That sick man had some skin disease, you know, he was all full of skin disease. He was very unhappy. So when the abbot came, the sick man was very happy. And because abbot and all the people at the monastery, they are, you know, we feel that they pray so much and we want their blessings and all that. So that sick man was very happy to see the abbot, and the abbot gave him those fruits and he said, see, you are very sick and you will be actually be able to enjoy the beauty of God. And so enjoy this and this will do you good and you will get recovered quickly. So the sick man, you know, thanked him and was very happy that the abbot had given this to him. They were so beautiful that the sick man kept looking at him, looking at the grapes, and then said, no, I don't think I deserve them. The cook from the monastery, he comes every day with such a lot of food, juices, medicines, the herbs, you know, he makes for me, grinds for me, and manually he does everything, and then comes and puts on all the whole of my body wherever I'm affected. So he is the one. He doesn't feel, you know, bad when he comes and serves me. He, such a good service he is giving to me. I'm a sick man with such a lot of diseases. There are so many people who don't want to come near me. But that cook comes and gives me medicine, puts medicine on my body, feeds me so nicely, bothers about me so much. He's the one. So these grapes were given to the cook when the cook came. The cook was very close to nature. He used to go, he had a kitchen garden. He used to pluck fruits and flowers, everything he had grown, you know. So he also praised, you know, this the grapes were actually grown very well, and it was a very good harvest, and by God's blessings they were actually very good and juicy. And so the cook, you know, insisted that no, you have them. So he said, no, I have them. If you gave whatever you give me, I also eat. So you are the one who deserves this better. So the cook was very happy, and the sick man said, see, if you really serve me and you love me, because every day you do so much for me and I don't have money to give to you, I can't do anything for you, but please, I want to thank you. Please take these grapes. So the cook said, all right, if he's, you know, wants to give, is he's insisting so much. He brought the grapes home to the monastery. He was the cook of the monastery. So he came to the monastery and kept it on the shelf in his room and kept looking at those grapes and felt, you know, that they were such beautiful and juicy grapes. He too felt that he didn't deserve. He had everything in the monastery. He had everything that could, he had grown everything so nicely. Felt, no, I don't deserve. This is a blessing of God. Whom should I give? So then the cook suddenly remembered that there was a new boy in the monastery, a newcomer who was not a priest, but he was a newcomer who had come there. So he said, see, I have seen so much in life. I'm an experienced man. I've eaten all this. This young boy who was so depressed and who came here and was taken in the monastery. He started staying in the monastery. He was a newcomer and he was a very sad and a depressed, grief-stricken boy. So he said, I think he is depressed and he needs to be motivated. So he will be able to understand the beauty of this gift of God, and he will be able to enjoy this. This will bring happiness in his life. He will feel happy if I give a gift to him, and he'll start staying happily. He'll try to forget, and he will come to know, this new boy will come to know that there are good people also, there are good deeds also. Everything will become okay. You know, there are ups and downs in a person's life, but we cannot stop living. The needles of the clock don't stop. Time goes on. We have to keep adjusting with circumstances. So the cook went to this new boy and he said, see, you are a new person. You will be able to taste the sweetness of this God's gift and sun's rays more and be happy about it, that there are good people, there are good times, everything will become okay, be positive. So, you know, he tried to motivate him and he gave him that bunch of grapes. The boy was very happy. Till now he was so grief-stricken, depressed, and he had come to the monastery so that he could stay here. Something bad had happened, you know, with him in life in the past. So now he had got this gift and he became very happy that after such a long time, someone had thought about him and had gifted him these beautiful grapes. So when the cook went away and he sat down and he started admiring the beauty of grapes, then suddenly he felt, do I really deserve this? I have become happy, satisfied, content. I've started living here because of that monk who was at the gate that day. He took me in. He motivated me. He, you know, supported me. He was the person who hugged me. And I cried and took out all, you know, my sad facts in front of him. He is the man. I am no one to, you know, even taste one from this. He quickly went to the same person, to the same monk the villager had given the bunch to. The first monk. He went there. And again, he knocked his room's door, and when the door was opened, the monk was surprised to see the same bunch of grapes, you know, go round and round and come back to him. He was totally shocked. He said, "Why? Where did you get them from?" He said, "I don't know. The cook gave them to me." "You are the one who took me in. You are the one who found me crying at the doorstep. You are the one who hugged me. You are the one who heard all about my grief. You are the one who said, 'Son, come and stay with me.' You are the one who changed my way of life. Otherwise, I would have ended my life. You stopped me from doing anything bad. You are the one who deserves these grapes." And the grapes were back again to the person who deserved. In your life also, whatever we do has to come back one day. You do good, I promise, one day you will be rewarded for that. Don't start expecting from the time you do good. Don't do good, you know, only to get things back. Keep doing good. Keep loving people. Keep supporting people. Keep giving your support, your hand to those people, especially who are in a very distressed condition. It will come back to you one day in some form of the or the other. So these were the blessings of God that were actually meant for this monk. You know, I told this story by taking a bunch of grapes. Bunch of grapes is just a medium. Do good, God will reward you in some way or the other, but definitely you will be rewarded. A short story along with this. I usually tell two stories together. So quickly, you know, there was a king. He didn't know, you know, king stays in the palace. Everything is good. People are so good. People keep saying yes, 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 yes. You know, all the courtiers, the ministers, everyone, you know, they keep nodding their head in front of the king. But how could he know who exactly is a good person? He didn't know much about his kingdom too. So one day he disguised in some other clothes, went to a nearby place, and then, you know, kept taking a round and all, and saw that his ministers were taking rounds and his courtiers were all here and there in the marketplace. So what he did was, at night, when it was dark, he brought a very, very big rock and kept it in the middle of the road. He blocked the road. No, there was not much space for things to go from here and there. So big rock, you know, he blocked the way and he hid behind the bushes. So when it became during the daytime, he kept, you know, hiding there, and he was disguised in some other clothes, and he saw, you know, who would remove it, the blocked road. Many of his ministers, you know, they kept shouting, "Who has kept this? How did this rock come here? Come on, get it removed." But no one touched it and went off. There were so many courtiers who, you know, walked from there and said, "I don't know who has kept this here." And then, you know, they went on their own course. So many people, you know, all, you know, crossed that way. Some cursed the king. Just imagine, this king is also doesn't know what is going on in the kingdom. These courtiers also, they are shouting, and these ministers and these soldiers, everybody is shouting, but no one is removing. So there were people who was cursing the king, who were talking bad about the king, bad about the palace, bad about the courtiers, the ministers, and everybody. No one removed it. The king was shocked. But he kept sitting there. He said, all right, at least one day I will wait. So after some time, this poor farmer was on his way. He had vegetables and all in his cart. And now he reached here. And he said, oh God, how do I cross? But there were others, you know, who had crossed somehow or the other. He thought, you know, there was still space. He could, you know, go up and down and go. But he said, no, but this is an obstruction for the other people too. So he took his cart somehow from the side. All right. And he tied it at one corner. Then brought some tools, some, you know, big sticks and all. And with a lot of struggle, you know, he tried to push it and tried to remove it. And with a lot of hard work, he was able to remove that rock. When he moved the rock from that place and made it fall down, you know, there was a big drain and it could go there. When it went there, he saw a red color purse or a pouch lying over there. And he was shocked to see that there was this under this rock. So he opened it. And there, that bag was full of gold coins. Full of gold coins. And there was a note from the king. This is for the hardworking person who, without cursing the others, will work on their own, will remove this rock. And then there was a signature of the king. The king didn't come out. He didn't have to show that he was there. The farmer was very, very happy. Very, very happy. He went home happily, you know, with this pouch. But he couldn't use that, you know. He felt, no, I still need to ask the king. So he first went home. He had his cart, his vegetables, everything. And he wanted to change his clothes and then go to the king. He was shocked to see the king. You know, this man, you know, who was disguised, the king who was disguised as a man, knocked the door of his house when he reached home. And he said, he went inside, closed the door, and first he asked for water. He went inside and then he, you know, said, I want you to come to my arms. I want you to, you know, hug me. I am the king of this city. And you were the one who removed the rock. Because you are so hardworking. We need such hardworking people in my palace. So from tomorrow, you will be appointed as my personal minister from tomorrow onwards. And just imagine the happiness of the farmer. This farmer believed in hard work. He did not curse anyone. He thought about the others too. He was able to remove his cart from there, but he did not go. He, you know, tied his cart there and then he removed that rock, which he felt would be an obstacle for the others. And see, he did good and he got good. Otherwise, he would have never ever thought of seeing the king or even visiting the palace any day. But he got the job and then his life was full of happiness. So do good, whatever little good you can do, keep doing, because God is watching us. He will definitely reward us in some way or the other. Do let me know. How are my stories? And please comment, like, take care of yourself, keep doing good. Love you all. Bye bye.